2 Corinthians 9. We're going to hop, skip, and jump, so I'm not going to read a particular passage within those passages. But I'm unashamed, I'm unabashed in addressing the issue of giving. Again, it's not a drum we beat. We don't even have a public offering here at Kindred. We've got free will offering boxes. We leave it to the Spirit of God to move the people of God to support the work of God. Yet the Bible addresses this issue. And if I'm a preacher of the gospel, I don't need to be frightened or ashamed to address the issue of money. In fact, the biblical writers have strong feelings about money. And we ought to have strong feelings about it also. Think about King Solomon. And how often he addresses money management in the book of Proverbs. The majority of Jesus' parables in the Gospels address money and financing God's kingdom. Think about the Apostle Paul. There's a whole chapter in 1 Timothy addressed to the issue of money. And we're coming here in the middle of his second letter to the Corinthians and looking at chapters 8 and 9, which addresses the issue of a collection for the church in Jerusalem and how the people of God ought to give. My message is called Give Your All in Giving, or In Giving, Give Your All. Take your pick. Keep your Bible open, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. 1854, the American statesman and father of the state of Texas, politician and soldier, Sam Houston, came to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was married to a Christian woman, a godly woman, who prayed for his salvation. And at times, she must have been tempted to give up, because Sam Houston was known as the big drunk. He was a fighter, and he was a man given to boozing. But the Lord wrestled him to the ground, saved his soul, changed his life, and he decided to go public with his faith in the act of baptism. 1854, November the 19th. He was baptized by Rufus Burleson, the pastor of Independence Baptist Church, who would later become the president of Baylor University. He was baptized in Little Rocky Creek. And as he was about to go into the water to be baptized, someone noticed that his very nice and fine leather wallet was still in his pocket. And they asked him would he like to take it out and give them it as he was getting into the waters to be baptized. And he responded, no. He said, my pocketbook needs baptized as well. And that's actually what happened. He got baptized with his wallet in his pocket. When he comes out, he commits to paying the salary of his local Baptist pastor. And when he was asked why he did it, he said, well, my pocketbook was baptized along with me. I love the story. And I love the implication of the story. Every Christian should have a baptized billfold. Every Christian should have a baptized billfold. Because when you and I surrender our life to the Lord Jesus Christ, we also consciously put all that we are and all that we have at his disposal. That means putting our wallet, billfold, pocketbook, and purse at the disposal of the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't think I need to tell you, but it bears repeating that when you and I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, it means that everything we have belongs to him. Our time, our talent, our treasure. And you know what? Proverbs 3 verse 9 says this, honor the Lord with your possessions. Isn't that interesting? Honor the Lord with your possessions. Whatever you own materially, whatever belongs to you financially belongs to him. Put it at his disposal. I love 1 Chronicles 29 and verse 11. The context is the building of the temple and the offering of God's people to support that work. And David celebrates their generosity. We read, therefore, David blessed the Lord before all the assembly. And David said, blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, our Father forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power and the glory, the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and all that is in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you. And you reign over all. In your hand is power and might. In your hand is to make great and to give strength to all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to offer so willingly as this? For all things come from you, and of your own we have given you. Isn't that an interesting little phrase? Lord, we have given you what you have given us. When you and I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, to whom all things belong, then all things that we have belongs to him. So let's think this through, this idea of giving, of honoring God, magnifying the gospel, extending God's kingdom, exercising trust, loving our neighbor, and securing eternal happiness for ourselves through our giving. You and I are stewards, right? 1 Corinthians 4, verses 1 to 2. We're stewards. We've got to manage every moment of our day, every hour of the morning, every day of the week. We've got to steward and manage our gifts and our talents and our opportunities to use them. We've got to manage our wealth and our income to support our family and support the Lord's work and help the poor. I like what Martin Luther, the Protestant reformer, said. Every Christian must experience three conversions: a conversion of the heart, a conversion of the mind, and a conversion of the wallet. I don't know where you're at on those three conversions, but I hope today will convert your wallet. So we're going to go to 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. We're going to kind of hop, skip, and jump across this passage. Let's just get our bearings. The background to this passage is a collection of money for the church in Jerusalem from Gentile assemblies of God's people. And Paul is doing that. You can read about it in 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 to 4, and Romans 15, 25 to 27. Now remember, the church at Jerusalem was struggling. 3,000 people had got saved, and many who had come from afar were now living in Jerusalem, and they were challenging that church's ability to minister. You read the book of Acts, there was a famine in Jerusalem. Read the book of Acts, and the church is under pressure and under persecution. And so Paul believes that one of the ways he can help the church in Jerusalem is to go all to all of these kind of virgin, emerging Gentile churches throughout the Roman Empire and say, will you give to your brothers and sisters in Jerusalem? And then secondarily, he's thinking, wouldn't that be a wonderful way of unifying the church? We know from the book of Acts there was some tension between Jewish believers and Gentile believers, and Paul's thinking, here's a way to cement the unity of the church. Plus, if you read in chapter 8, verses 10 and 11, or chapter 9, verses 2 and 3 of the passage we're looking at, they had kind of already committed to giving a year earlier. And now Paul's saying, hey, the year's up. Don't embarrass yourself. Don't embarrass me. You need to give what you said you'd give. So that's where we're at. Now, one of us today is not about scolding. It's not about putting you under pressure to give that which you do want to give. What I want you to see in this passage is the joy and the privilege and the benefits of giving. In giving, give your all. Give your all in giving for several reasons. One, if you're taking notes, here's where we start. In giving, we praise. We praise God. That's reason enough. That's motive enough. As with all of life, we seek with our money to magnify and glorify God within the church and before a watching world. In his first letter, Paul says what? 1 Corinthians 10, 31. In your eating and in your drinking, and in whatever you do, which would include your giving, whatever you do, do it to the glory of God. We just read, didn't we, Proverbs 3, verse 9, or we at least quoted it, honor the Lord with your possessions. From your car, to your wallet, to your house, to your food, to your accommodation. Make sure that all of that is at God's disposal and you're using it for His glory. This certainly is a theme in these two chapters. Now, the immediate goal, as we've said, is the alleviation of the church in Jerusalem, to bring relief to brothers and sisters there. But the ultimate goal is the glory of God among the nations, because God is the source of all good things. Let me give you a few verses to look at chapter 8 and verse 19. Notice the language: to the glory of the Lord Himself. To the glory of the Lord Himself. That this collection for the relief of the church in Jerusalem is to the glory of God Himself. We're taking that which He has given us, and we're giving it to His people, who will rejoice in His presence for answered prayer. God's getting glory in all of this. Look at verse 23. It talks about the messengers of the churches to the glory of Christ. Look at chapter 9 and verse 11. That thanksgiving is being given to God for what is taking place. Again, you see the idea of glorifying God in obedient giving in verse 13. You get the point. In giving, we praise. God loves it. God is honored by it. God sees obedience in it. We can honor God with our money. It is no small thing to manage your money. It's a spiritual thing. It's an eternal thing. It's an important thing. That's why you've got to make your money honestly. That's why you've got to hold it lightly. That's why you've got to budget it appropriately. That's why you've got to speak about it wisely. And that's why you've got to give it generously. I don't know if R.G. Letourneau is a name familiar to all of you or many of you, but it's a fascinating story. He was tied into CBMC, which many of our men have been involved in for many years. His life story is an amazing one. He would ultimately become the builder of great machines. And he was known for that throughout the world. Before that, he was a woodcutter, a bricklayer, a farmhand, a miner, an electronic machinist, and a carpenter. And then he became a contractor, and he was a self-taught engineer who eventually became a businessman. Let me help you understand who he was. Listen, 70% of the earth-moving equipment and engineering vehicles that the Allied forces used during World War II was built by R.G. Letourneau and his factories. In fact, after the war, he invented manufacturing machines that led most of the original highway infrastructure in the United States. This is no small man. He was creative, he was a visionary, he was a hard worker. By the end of his life, he had 300 patents. Now, his sister was a missionary, and for a time, as he headed down the business path and began to make some good money, she challenged him about his commitment to business and money. And she said, you know what, you should give that all up and become an evangelist, a pastor, or a missionary. And R.G. Letourneau went to a pastor for counsel, and the pastor gave him good counsel, by the way. And he said, R.G., God needs businessmen as much as He needs preachers and missionaries. And so he stuck at it. And at some point he decided, given what he was enjoying, but I think fairly early on, he decided to live on 10% of his income and give 90% away. You pastor, you mean he kept 90 and give 10 away? No, the opposite. He kept 10 and gave 90% away. He built universities. He created missionary technicians that went throughout the world helping the Lord's work. He was famous for a couple of statements. He was famous for this statement: I try to shovel out more for God than He can for me, but He always wins because His shovel's bigger. He was famous for this statement: it's not a question of how much of my money I'm going to keep give to God. It's always a question of how much of God's money I'm going to keep for myself. Right? When he died, the words of Matthew 6:33 were written on his headstone: seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. In giving, we praise. We're to honor God. We're to bless God. Let's do that. Secondly, in giving, we're to prize. In giving, we're to prize. What do I mean by that? Well, in giving, we praise God, but also in our giving, we prize, treasure, and make much of the Lord Jesus and his gospel. Go back to chapter 8 of 2 Corinthians in verse 9. This is a verse we quote often in the gospel and in preaching the gospel, but it's a verse related to giving in the church. Here's what it says: for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty may become rich. Paul has talked about the glory of God. Now he talks about the gospel of Christ. And Christ set aside his glory, clothed himself in humanity, so that he might bear our sin on the cross, that he might make atonement through his blood for you and for me, so that when you and I put our faith where God put our sin, in the substitutionary death of Jesus Christ, we become the recipients of God's amazing grace. Didn't we see that in Ephesians 1, verse 7? And in Ephesians 2, verse 7, which talks about the riches of his grace? See, every Christian is a person that's rich in the favor of God, what has come freely to them through the price of Jesus' death. James Montgomery Boyce talks about the four steps and stages of this verse. The first step is Christ's riches. This is Christ before his incarnation. This is Christ dwelling and basking before his incarnation, where he's worshipped by the angels, where none of his glory is hidden and none of his prerogatives have been limited, where he exists in glory and majesty as the maker of all things. But then Christ's riches turn into Christ's poverty, where he adds humanity to his deity. He becomes enfleshed so that he might bear our sin in his body on the tree. And he impoverishes himself, and he empties himself, and he limits his prerogatives, and he endures the mockery of man, and he gives his life a ransom for many. And here's the third stage: our poverty. Christ's riches led to Christ's poverty. And then we have our poverty. That's you and me in debt to God. That's you and me in moral arrears for all the sins we have committed and the just payment of those sins that are due. We're lost, we're damned, we're impoverished. Yet our poverty is turned into riches because Christ's riches was turned into poverty. And as you and I put our faith in Jesus Christ, we're given justification. We're given the indwelling Holy Spirit. We're given a peace that passes all understanding. We're given great and exceeding promises. I've told the story many times because I love to tell it, of the tax assessor back in the old day, back in the old country, where he was going house to house asking them to list their possessions. That was the day in which you were taxed on your silverware or your jewelry or something precious in the home. And this man was poor by that measure, and he was asked to list his possessions. He said this: I have everlasting life. I have a mansion in heaven. I have peace that passes understanding. I have joy unspeakable. I have divine love that never fails. I have a faithful wife. I have healthy, beautiful, obedient children. I have loyal friends. And I have a crown of life awaiting me in the life to come. The tax assessor looked at him and said, sir, you're a rich man, and none of that is taxable. That's the point. Now, what's the implication? You and I who have received the grace of God given in Jesus Christ will end up being giving people. Because the gospel creates in us an impulse of grace and giving. Notice the word grace. Paul has talked about the grace of our Lord Jesus in the gospel. Rich to poor, so that we who are poor move to rich. And in chapter 8, verse 1, he talks about the grace of God that was bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, who although were in affliction and who were in poverty themselves, gave liberally. The grace of God in the gospel produced this liberality in them. You see the word grace used in verses 6 and 7 of chapter 8, where they would complete this grace. Chapter 8, verse 9, we read when we get into chapter 9, verse 7 and 8, so let each one of you give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. The good work of giving. What produces the good work of giving? The good work of the cross. And what produces this grace to give to other believers at a cost to oneself? Well, it's the cost Jesus was willing to pay for you. And that produces a reciprocal response. Their giving was a reflex to God's giving. Their giving, first and foremost, was not a response to human need, but divine love. Now, they will respond to human need. They will be moved by compassion to help the brothers and sisters in Jerusalem who are overcrowded, who are facing persecution, and who are dealing with famine. They will be moved by that, but that's not the first impulse. It's the love of God and love for God. Thirdly, in giving, we partner. In giving, we partner. What do I mean by that? See, when we share material goods and wealth with other believers, it's not just physical, it's spiritual. There's a fellowship, there's a bond in that. That's not a matter of dollars and cents. In fact, Paul uses, interestingly, the word fellowship when he speaks about their giving. Look at chapter 8 and verse 4. In fact, we'll read verse 3. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. That's our word koinonia. They shared, they had this in common. Their commonality in Christ brought about a commonality in sharing with one another physically and materially and financially. You see it again in chapter 9, verse 13, where we read about the obedience of their giving as a confession of the gospel, and that they liberally shared with them and all men. That's our word, koinonia, share. Listen. Paul ties finances to fellowship. Paul ties coins to koinonia. You and I prove that we love the brothers and that we're one with each other in the gospel through our giving. I mean, you see it on the day of Pentecost, don't you? I mean, the first breath of the church she emerges into life. Chapter 2, verse 44, those first Christians, we read, now all who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. In giving, we partner. Fellowship in the New Testament has economic implications. Giving was not a private matter. It was done in the light of the needs of the body of Christ. We just don't love in word, do we? 1 John 3:18, we love in word and deed. It's not just between you and the Lord what you give. It's between you and the Lord's people what you give. Because it's partnership. It's fellowship. It's ministering to one another. I love the story of John Wesley, who wrote to encourage a struggling Methodist preacher. The circumstances were tough and the times were hard financially. And so John Wesley wrote him a beautiful letter and a card, and he gave him some verses to be encouraged in regarding God's love and provision. And then he put a few notes, pound notes, in there for good measure. The brother wrote back how much he was encouraged by the words and the verses from the Bible, and he was greatly encouraged by the expository notes that accompanied them. The pound notes were the expository notes. I love it that you didn't just love me in word, but you loved me in word and deed. And you partnered with me and you shared your wealth in my poverty that I might continue to share the gospel. Two more and we'll wrap this up. In giving, we please. In giving, we please. That is, not only please God, whom we honor, but we please ourselves as we experience the Spirit-produced joy of giving. Remember what the Lord Jesus said, and Paul repeats it to the elders at Ephesus, Acts 20, 33 to 35. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Have you tested that verse recently? Have you proved it recently? The Lord tells us, doesn't he, in Malachi 3, prove me. Prove me. It's been well said that money cannot buy happiness, but giving money to the gospel and to the ends of evangelism brings about a happiness, a state of blessedness, as we know what we're doing glorifies God. What we're doing attaches us to the body of Christ in real expressions of love, and the doing of that, and a rejoicing in the gospel as a motive, we find joy. There's more happiness in giving than receiving. If we had gone to Israel just a few weeks ago, we would have taken our people to the Sea of Galilee in the north and the Dead Sea in the south. And both seas are fed by the same river, the River Jordan. Now, the Sea of Galilee is teeming with life, fish, and vegetation. But the Dead Sea is full of salt. It's dead. There's no life there. The concentration of sodium just kills everything in and around it. And how can that be? How can one sea be alive and another sea be dead when they're fed by the same river? It's very simple. The River Jordan flows into the Sea of Galilee and flows out of the Sea of Galilee. And the River Jordan flows into the Sea of Galilee, out of the Sea of Galilee, and into the Dead Sea, and it doesn't flow out. No outlet. The Dead Sea doesn't give. It doesn't reciprocate. It doesn't share. You want to enjoy life? You want to enjoy God's favor? You want to enjoy a state of blessedness? Give. Giving produces life. The gospel teaches us that. And those who have enjoyed the gospel come to enjoy that. In fact, we see here, don't we? Chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians, verse 7. So let us give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. That word cheerful is actually weak. It's the Greek word that gives us the word hilarious or hilarity. God loves a hilarious giver. You know? As you leave today, hopefully as you get to the box, we hear you laughing. Or, you know, whatever that means, I think it's more of a heart issue. It's not a giddiness. It's just saying there's a joy. There's a blessing. It's life-giving to share. There's three types of givers. There's the tearful giver, right, who's begrudging. There's the fearful giver who gives out a compulsion. I wonder what God will do to me if I don't do this. Or there's the cheerful giver who gives out a grace. God has been so good. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Jesus was rich, became poor. I was poor and have been made rich. All of that produces a joy. We don't want to be like the little boy many years ago when a quarter meant something. He was given a quarter and a dime by his father as he headed to Sunday morning Sunday school. And his father said, look, I want you to put the quarter in the offering at the Sunday school and you can buy yourself, you know, a stick of rock on the way home from your with your dime. And when he came home, the little fella was quick to admit, Dad, he said, I want to tell you the truth. He says, I kept the quarter and I put the dime in the offering plate. And the dad said, well, why did you do that? I told you to put the quarter in the offering plate and buy yourself some candy with the dime. He says, well, that morning, the teacher told us that God loves a cheerful giver, and I was happier to give a dime than I was to give a quarter. Well, okay, it's a little bit of a nonsense story, but that's the point. This is an attitude. You'll notice the words are, so let each one give as he purposes in his heart. Not according to his bank balance. Not after he's crunched the numbers and looked at the margins and said, I think we can afford this. No, it's more spontaneous than that. It's more free than that. It's more generous and cheerful than that. It's from the heart that's exploding with a love for God's glory and a love for the brethren and a reveling in the love of God and the gospel. That's why small gifts can be big. And big gifts can be small because the measure's determined by the heart orientation. Early in their marriage, Billy and Ruth Graham were visiting a church where Billy was preaching. And during the offering, an usher came to the platform and pushed the offering plate in front of the guest evangelist, which wasn't normal, but, you know, Billy reached into his wallet and he pulled out what he thought was a dollar bill, and as he dropped it in the plate, he realized he had given his one and only $10 bill away, and there was no double dipping, so off it went. And he kind of sank in his heart, realizing the mistake he had made, and further complicating matters, when he had finished preaching, they gave him no honorarium. So he was doubly down as he got into the car. And as they were driving home, he was sharing that all with Ruth. And instead of sympathizing with her, she said, and just think this, the Lord will give you credit for the $1 you give, not the $10 that was taken, because you only meant to give $1. It's from the heart that makes a difference. Okay, the last thought. In giving, we profit. Now, I've kept this for last, but I'm not going to ignore it. Okay, I want to get the hierarchy of importance. God's glory, most important. Testifying to the gospel, most important. Loving others before yourself, most important. But I want to tell you, giving rebounds. There's a boomerang effect to giving that the Bible doesn't shy away from. When you and I invest in the gospel, in the kingdom of God, and in our brothers, God is glorified and you are benefited. It pays dividends to be generous. Look at, as we wrap it up, 2 Corinthians 9. Let's begin at verse 6. For this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for the Lord loves a hilarious giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, that you, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. As it's written, he who has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Notice the word forever there. We're not dealing with something that's eternal, something that ripples in its effect out into the life to come. Verse 10, now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for the food, supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. while you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. Paul uses the image from Deuteronomy 15, 10 and 11 of reaping and sowing, or sowing and reaping. Paul encourages them in the light of this picture that, you know, the more the farmer sows, the more generous and sparing he is in the scattering of his seed, the more he has at harvest time. And Paul is saying, when you and I sow materially into God's work, not sparingly but generously, there's a harvest. There's a law of the harvest. What you sow, you reap. In the same measure you sow, you reap. And so we're being reminded here to be generous, but to remember that you will never outgive God. Back to R.G. Letourneau. Well, I've shoveled out what God has shoveled in, but I've never been able to beat him because his shovel is bigger than mine. And what about Proverbs 11? Write these verses down. I'll read them to you. You probably haven't looked at them for a while. Proverbs 11, 24. There is one who scatters yet increases more. And there is one who withholds more than is right, and it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. I've had a ringside seat on this. I grew up in a blue-collar family where my mom and dad watched their budget because they had to. But I can tell you this, from the day I became conscious, I was conscious of the fact that my father took that meager wages from the factory, and without fail, he set aside on the Lord's day that which the Lord had prospered him with. I look back and I wonder how my mom and dad raised three of us. And we have all done well in life. We've done better than our parents did. And yet to this day, my dad will be here in a few weeks. He's turning 90. My mom lived into her mid-80s. They own their little home. They've got spending money, or my dad is enough to travel and do things, and we've tried to repay him for his generosity towards us. If I was to try and decipher my dad's life, I would add in, maybe he lives long because he honored his mother and father all the days of his life, which he did. And he has honored the Lord with his possessions. I remember watching my father give preachers extra on a Sunday who were visiting the church because he knew the hardships many of them were going through. I was impressed by that, challenged by that. You know, sometimes didn't react well. Dad, what are you doing giving the money away? I've got a pair of DM boots you tell me we can't afford. But you get to see it in how has he sowed, so he reaped. And as he watered others, he himself has been watered. In giving, we profit in this life and in the life to come. Matthew 6, 19 to 20, right? Lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven. Well, how do you lay up treasure in heaven? By using your treasure on earth in a manner that glorifies God, reflects the gospel, loves the brothers. And profits you. 1 Timothy 6, verse 19. Paul speaks to the rich in the church at Ephesus. And he encourages them to be rich in good works with their riches. And he says this, let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold of eternal life. Isn't that the paradox that Jim Elliot would remind us of? Don't be a fool. And you are no fool if you, you know, give away what you can't keep. And enjoy that for all of eternity. He is no fool who, you know, gives what he cannot keep for that which he cannot lose. As the team comes up, George Pepperdine, the founder of Western Auto and the benefactor of that beautiful campus over there in Pepperdine University, he enjoyed wealth and he gave it away. He did it sparingly and generously. And then towards the end of his life, he lost his complete fortune. And people tried to encourage him and comfort him. And he said this, "In the end, all I have left is what I have given away. And I'm okay with that. I haven't lost what I gave away. I lost what I kept." He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep for that which he cannot lose. You want to know how rich you are? Add up all that money cannot buy and death cannot steal. That's spiritual riches. That's the dividend that comes from giving your all in giving. Lord, we thank you for our time in the Word. Lord, I thank you for this congregation and its obedience over the years to this ministry and its faithful giving and sacrificial giving and generous giving. I pray that today, for most of us, it will be simply being put in remembrance of good things, that we would continue to do what we're doing with what you have given. I pray for the young believer. I pray for the young person who's starting out in life and who's managing a budget, which is a challenge in Southern California. But I pray that they would factor this teaching into their budget, that they would not postpone giving to the Lord when times are more propitious, when times are better, when there's more margin. Lord, there's not a season in life where we get to be disobedient. I pray for those who know this but are willfully disobeying it, whose hearts have grown cold or materialistic, who are being possessed by their possessions. I pray that you would bring them to a place where they hold what they have lightly and remember that it all belongs to you. They belong to you. Riches come from you. You've promised to give in the light of our giving. I pray for an increase of faith and obedience. Lord, we pray for a good end of the year. We pray your prosperity on all that we seek to do for your honor and your glory. We know that if we obey this text, there'll come a day in the future when we stand before you. We will and will not regret obeying it. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.